Thank you very much, and welcome to the Stephen Decatur birthday celebration. We're glad you're here. This is the, we're celebrating the 200th anniversary of Admiral Stephen Decatur finishing this house and moving in, and at the time, there were three structures on Lafayette Square, and it was the White House, St. John's Church, and the Decatur House. So it's a very special place, and we're delighted that you're here. I want to recognize our board members that are here, Martha Kumar, Anita McBride, Ann Stock, Gail West, and Bob McGee. Have I missed anyone? Did I miss seeing anyone? Also, the National Council members that are here, we appreciate your support. Also, very pleased to have Secretary Jim Nicholson, Secretary Will Ball, Admiral Rich Meese, and the program participants I'll introduce later, but we're really pleased to have Ann Compton as serving as our moderator, Midshipman Zach Abey, Vice Admiral Ted Carter, and Admiral John Harvey, who will be participating in our panel. We are very pleased to have two Decatur family members, great nephews of the Commodore. Stephen and Benjamin Decatur are 9th and 10th generation nephews of Commodore Decatur. So we're delighted to have them. And and now I'd like to introduce Margaret Kibben, the Rear Admiral Margaret Kibben, who will do our invocation, and she is was the 26th Chief of Chaplains of the Navy, and prior to that was the Chief of Chaplains of the Marine Corps, and was the first woman to hold either of those capacities, so we're delighted to have Margaret.
Would you pray with me? Almighty God, whose ways are in the sea and whose paths are in the great waters, as we celebrate the birthday of one of America's storied heroes, we pause to give you thanks. In setting before us the example of Stephen Decatur's intrepidity, his courage, and his fortitude throughout the littorals of North Africa into the harbor of Tripoli and throughout his life, you have reminded us that when we are unswerving in our purpose and when our purpose is grounded in virtue, that your presence abides with us even when the odds are stacked in opposition. And so we pray that as we reflect on Commodore Decatur's most bold and daring acts, that we understand that even now you call us to act as bravely in our service to this country, to keep our sights on those sailors who even today risk life and limb to protect the freedom of navigation, to lead carefully those men and women who leave home port and home fires to maintain watch over the seas, to live lives of devotion to justice, even when it costs us our life. May our celebration today in this hero's house remind us of our obligation to the virtues you call this country to uphold. Indeed, we too pray she always be in the right, but when in the wrong, may she yield to your direction and purpose. Hear then our gratitude for all your gifts, which reveal your rich grace. Bless the food and this fellowship, that our faithfulness to you would be fortified. It is in the strength of your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much, Admiral Kibben. And right now, I normally would introduce Stuart McLaurin, who is our president of the White House Historical Association. However, He is incapacitated in that he is on the West Coast cheering for Alabama to roll tide, roll, that the tide will roll again tonight. But we're very pleased to have Matt Costello, who is the senior historian, to tell you a little about the White House Historical Association. So, Matt, would you please come forward?
Thank you, Secretary Dalton. Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Matthew Costello, and I am the senior historian for the White House Historical Association. Welcome to the fourth annual Stephen Decatur Jr. Birthday Luncheon. First, let me tell you a little bit more about the association, our mission, and what we do. We are a private, nonprofit educational organization founded in 1961 for the purpose for enhancing public understanding, appreciation, and enjoyment of the Executive Mansion. It was created at the recommendation of the National Park Service with strong support from First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy. All proceeds from the sale of the association's books and products are used to fund the acquisition of historic furnishings and artwork for the permanent White House collection, to assist in the preservation of public rooms, and to further our educational mission. In recent years, the association's outreach has become more technologically sophisticated. With the development of our growing digital library, the White House Experience mobile app, which if you haven't downloaded it yet, please do. It's like you're touring the White House in real time. And the 1600 Sessions podcast. I knew, even though Stuart is here in spirit, I would promote his podcast. Be sure you listen. All of these great resources are supported and shared through our social media platforms and with members of the media, teachers, researchers, scholars, undergraduate and graduate students, as well as the general public. While the association continues to expand its content reach across the country, we are also digging deeper into the history in plain sight. In 2010, the association entered into a stewardship agreement with the National Trust for Historic Preservation, establishing the David M. Rubenstein National Center for White House History. It has been and remains a privilege to work together to enhance the interpretation of Decatur House and the adjoining historic slave quarters. Last summer, in tandem with the launch of our new book, The Stephen Decatur House, A History, Rubenstein Center staff began a new research initiative on slavery in the president's neighborhood. While there is little evidence that the Decaturs themselves owned slaves, subsequent residents of the home brought many enslaved peoples with them, or simply hired out free and enslaved African Americans prior to the Civil War. Their history is also within these walls. And we encourage you to visit the slave quarters today after today's program to learn more about these figures and their experiences. So when Stuart asked me to fill in for him, I decided that I would tell a story. This was early in my tenure here when I was doing some research on Stephen Decatur, and I found a newspaper article from the Chicago Daily Tribune in 1883 where the writer is quoting a recollection, something that their mother told them about her experience visiting Decatur House. And I quote, "The house occupied and owned by General Beale is the one made famous by Decatur's life and death within its walls. There used to be preserved carefully in the front hall a glass globe about 2 feet in diameter, which possessed a gruesome fascination for me. For my mother had told me how she would stare at the blood-stained garments that were enclosed in its hollow sphere. They were the clothes worn by Decatur when they brought him home, done to death by the red-handed baron, and they were drenched in places with his blood. Mrs. Decatur had them put in the globe and never allowed them to be touched." Now, it's probably not a very good story to tell right before we eat lunch, but I started doing some digging, and according to the inventory after Stephen Decatur's death, inventory of his estate, there were in fact two globes, one of which at that time, according to the documentation, was perhaps in President McLaurin's office, but I decided since I was only 2 months into my new job that breaking open Stuart's globe probably wasn't the best way to develop a rapport with him. But when I went back through the documentation, I realized that these were globes that actually were owned by the Beals. Unfortunately, I didn't track down the supposed globe filled with Decatur's bloody garments. But I think the anecdote tells us a few things about the memory of Stephen Decatur. First, His untimely demise was indeed one of the great tragedies of the early republic. When we consider his record and his service to the country, one cannot help but wonder, what if? Perhaps he would have served in Congress, the cabinet, Secretary of the Navy, or even perhaps as President of the United States. Second, public fascination with Decatur never really faded, as legends surrounding his naval service, his rivalry with James Barron, and the duel continued well into the 19th century. Finally, during his lifetime, 60 years after his death, when the article was written, to today, his story captures our imaginations and inspires future generations to serve their country and others selflessly. Our fascination with him, however morbid in some instances, exemplifies our genuine human need as a people to connect more personally with our national heroes. It is in this spirit that we are gathered here today to commemorate and honor the life of Stephen Decatur Jr. Welcome to our campus. I hope you enjoy your lunch and our program today. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Please continue to enjoy your lunch. And in the interest of time, I think I will go ahead and make the introductions of the distinguished panel we have, and then they will come up to the stage. First of all, our moderator today is Ann Compton. Ann has always been a pioneer. She was the first woman assigned to cover the White House on network television, and with 41 years on the air for ABC News, her longevity and impact are unparalleled. She now combines her personal experiences on the White House beat with fresh scholarship from the prestigious Miller Center for Presidential Studies at the University of Virginia. Compton's career of ABC News at ABC News spanned 7 presidents and 10 presidential campaigns. Ann was traveling with President George W. Bush on 9/11/2001 and was the only broadcast reporter to remain on Air Force One to report on behalf of all the press during the chaotic hours following the terrorist attack. She says that that was the most significant story of her career. She has had numerous awards, including being inducted into 6 Halls of Fame and having received 5 honorary university degrees. However, her most special award was when she was given the golden statuette bestowed by the National Mother's Day Committee, naming her Mother of the Year in 1988. Midshipman Zach Abey graduated from Archbishop Spaulding here in Maryland, where he played football, wrestled, and was on the rugby team. After graduating from high school, he attended the Naval Academy Prep School in Newport, Rhode Island, and reported to the Naval Academy in July of 2015. Throughout his time at the Naval Academy, Zach has participated in varsity football as a quarterback. He played his first game against East Carolina as a sophomore and started his first game in the annual Army-Navy game at M&T State Bank Stadium in Baltimore. That's a tough way to break in as starting your first game. Well, he quarterbacked the next year as in his junior year and gained over 1,400 yards that year as a quarterback. And as most of you who follow football know, 1,000 yards to gained in 1 year is a big deal, and he gained 40% more than that. Yet when the coach had a different idea for someone to quarterback and wanted to move Zach Abey to end, and in the triple option, the end doesn't get much face time with respect to the football. It's mostly blocking and tackling. Zach Abey was a true team player and said, "Coach, whatever is better for the team, sign me up." That tells you an awful lot about the character of midshipman Zach Abey. He is a two-striper and is his company's representative to the honor committee. Zach was here in our first inaugural Stephen Decatur birthday 4 years ago. Which leads me to the first speaker at the inaugural Stephen Decatur birthday. And he did such a great job that we've brought him back twice more. Vice Admiral Walter E. Ted Carter, Jr. became the 62nd superintendent of the Naval Academy in 2014. He graduated from the Naval Academy in 1981 and was a naval flight officer in 1982. He has landed on 19 different aircraft carriers, was the commanding officer of Fighter Squadron VF-14, the Top Hatters, and was the commanding officer of USS Carl Vinson. He also served as the 54th president of the U.S. Naval War College in Newport. During his career, he flew 125 combat missions in support of joint operations in Bosnia, Kosovo, Kuwait, Iraq, and Afghanistan. In his career, he completed 2,016 combat-arrested landings, the most of any naval aviator in history, active or retired. Margaret and I spend a lot of time at the Naval Academy, and I can tell you that he has done a great job as our superintendent and will be retiring from that job in July of this year, and it has been a great run, and Ted, you've done a magnificent job, and we're grateful to you. Admiral John C. Harvey, Jr. was the commander of the U.S. Fleet Forces Command in Norfolk, Virginia. And in his 39-year Navy career, Admiral Harvey specialized in Navy nuclear propulsion, surface ship and carrier strike group operations, and Navy-wide management personnel policy. He was the chief of naval personnel, the senior uniformed human resources official in the Navy, and director of the Navy staff immediately prior to becoming the commander of U.S. Fleet Forces Command. Since his retirement, he is now on the board of the Navy Memorial Foundation and is serving now as the chairman of that board. He's also an outside director of A.T. Kearney. In 2014, Admiral Harvey was sworn in as a member of the Governor Terry McAuliffe's cabinet, where he served as the Commonwealth's Secretary of Veteran and Defense Affairs until August of 2017. He's a graduate of Phillips Exeter Academy, the U.S. Naval Academy, and the John F. Kennedy School of Government at Harvard. He's a four-star admiral and has had a brilliant career, is also well-known as a Navy historian, and is has had just an outstanding career. Please join me in welcoming the distinguished members of the panel who will be celebrating with us today.
Welcome, and thank you for joining us. I'm going to start with a question. Where the heck is Hollywood? Where is the big blockbuster movie, that sprawling saga about the naval hero at the very beginnings, the early hours of this nation, the one who dressed up in native local sailors' garb to sneak into the Tripoli Harbor, to come and not rescue, but blow up the USS Philadelphia, which had been taken hostage there? Where's the one who came back to Washington and came to Washington and enchanted an entire community and really brought a vivid, heroic life to all of us? Where is that Hollywood blockbuster? I think that any of you who, after listening to this panel today, will agree that somebody in Hollywood has to get cracking on this. I want to ask. I want to start with you, I want to start with Admiral John Harvey, because before we can talk about the legacy, we need to know a little bit more about the context, the moment, the time in history when Stephen Decatur, that young boy growing up in Philadelphia, watching the ships being built, what was that era for the young country and the young Navy like?
Well, I think what really struck me when you look at Stephen Decatur's life, and he's growing into his profession at the same time the United States is growing significantly, the Louisiana Purchase and 1803, America was trying to decide, what are we going to be, a bucolic nation of farmers up and down the East Coast, or is there something grander in our future? The Louisiana Purchase certainly answered part of that question, but the vast development of trade into the Mediterranean, which brings us to the heart of the Stephen Decatur story, was also going apace in the early 1800s. And there the flag follows trade has been true for thousands of years. And so the nation was expanding, the nation was growing, and it was fascinating, Ann, that the Navy was really became one of the faces of that nation. How did America see itself? How did it understand itself in the context of the times? Well, the Navy was growing at the same time. The Naval Act of 1794, signed by George Washington, got going with Joshua Humphreys on the famous Six Frigates, a wonderful book, if you ever read it, by Ian Toll, who tells the story of the development of those frigates and their construction. And they were the great ships of the War of 1812 that figured so prominently in Decatur's life. So as our nation was growing, as our nation was expanding, figuring out its future, the Navy was growing, the Navy was expanding and protecting the trade that was going to be at the basis for our country's economic development. So it was kind of two great streams came together, and I think that's why Decatur's life so captured the attention of the citizens at the time, because they knew it really mattered every day what was going on with him.
Admiral Ted Carter, the heroics that Stephen Decatur is credited with, why was he such a risk taker? You know his background and some of those highlights better than anyone.
Well, I think as Admiral Harvey pointed out, it was that moment in our nation's history where we were really trying to decide, are we going to be a land nation or a nation defined by, you know, our ocean border. His father had served in the Revolutionary War. He was a merchantman, so he was familiar with the sea. Much different period of how we created the future officers of the Navy back then. We still had midshipmen, but midshipmen were teenage boys that were put on ships to learn the trade. And he actually served as a midshipman on board the USS United States under really arguably the father of our Navy, John Barry, the first Commodore in our United States Navy, and he was actually on board this vessel, the USS United States, as she was launched as the first of the six frigates, and that's where he began his training. I think he also was exposed early to this odd phenomena of the time, that in this movie that should be made will just enrapture the American public. They had this this strange habit of holding up their honor by, you know, challenging each other to duels. And he experienced this early. And in fact, this one quick sea story that I'll tell, I think helps starts to define who Stephen Decatur became in his early role. Of the many midshipmen that he was on board the USS United States, one of them was a gentleman named Richard Summers. And Summers, like Decatur, would become famous. We've had six ships named after him. The second of those ships was actually the USS Summers, in which we hung the former Secretary of War, a midshipman named Spencer. And when that was discovered, it became the Summers affair. And that's actually how the Naval Academy was founded from 1843 to 1845. But as a midshipman, Richard Summers was challenged by Decatur himself. Summers had made fun of the way Decatur dressed. And in an offhand comment, Decatur said, "Midshipman Summers, you're foolish." And now became this thing where he had to defend his honor. And as midshipmen did, they were the go-between between the officers and the enlisted crew. And in the mess, the crewmen were making fun of Summers himself. And to show his mettle, midshipman Summers decided to duel three different apprentices on board the ship. The first one shot him in the arm, the second one shot him in the thigh, and as he was about to bleed out, midshipman Decatur, as his second, propped him up. And then midshipman Summers fired ahead of the fire code and shot the third apprentice, and that's how it ended. Summers lives, eventually dies in the Barbary Wars, but this is where Decatur learns this idea of no fear.
Let me ask Midshipman Zach Abey, thank you for joining us, because 138 days from today, you will graduate and start on your the rest of your career. Can you tell us real quickly what drew you to the Navy, what drew you to the Academy, and what it is about Stephen Decatur lives on for those of you who are in today's Navy?
Yeah, I actually grew up in Pasadena, Maryland, so I've been around the Academy life all my life, just growing up and watching football games, going to the Academy, and it's been something I've always dreamed about doing, and I was lucky enough to be able to play football here as well. But I think one of the major traits that Stephen Decatur had that we're taught from day one in plebe summer is to be a selfless and servant leader. You know, for me, I was lucky enough to have a really good squad leader in my plebe summer. And, you know, not only when we're getting, you know, IT'd in the hallway, which is intensive training, but he would show us that servant leadership, because if we had to do push-ups, he would be on his face doing push-ups with him. And that was my first kind of interaction with a leader that I kind of aspired to be, because he knew that, you know, as we were going through this pain, he would do it with them. And I think that's something that Stephen Decatur had, especially just knowing that if he was outnumbered 5-1, he still went on the ship first. And then even after setting the USS Philadelphia on fire, he was the last one to leave the ship. So he would never expect any of his men or women that follow him to do anything more than what he would do. And I think that's a big thing we learned from the Academy, and that's something I would take forward throughout my entire experience.
Wonderful. I want to go back to Admiral Carter for a minute to talk about the Macedonia and that chapter of this movie that we're all going to go see is got to be, if not a climax, close to.
Yeah, I mean, as we're all assembled here today, honoring what would be the 240th birthday of Stephen Decatur, we're also recognizing the third Congressional Gold Medal that was bestowed upon him, which was for his actions in the year 1812 of the USS United States, the very ship that he would become a midshipman on and eventually command. So as we entered into really what was our first nation's true war that would be formed at sea against Great Britain on June 18th, 1812, it would not take long for our ships to deploy. from cities like New York, from Norfolk, from Boston. In this case, Stephen Decatur deployed, now in command of USS United States, coming out of Boston, sailed east to meet these hundreds of British ships, mostly fighting frigates, and now looking at them. Ironically, the HMS Macedonia would actually be stationed right there in Norfolk in 1810. In fact, Stephen Decatur was on board the USS United States, parked in Norfolk Harbor next to the Macedonia, and met the captain, John Carden.
No relation.
And they had a bet. And they had a bet if they ever met in combat, the losing commanding officer would have to give a beaver pelt hat to the winner. So here they are, traveling east, 500 miles south of the Azores, just off the island of Madeira. And at 9 o'clock in the morning, over the horizon, Stephen Decatur spies a 154-foot-long ship, three-masted frigate. And he immediately recognized it as HMS Macedonia. Now, unlike some of his previous exploits where he was brash, outnumbered 5-1, and going to battle, going ship to ship, this is a battle which he actually used his naval intellect and his smarts to win at sea. He recognized that he had a bigger ship. The USS United States had 400 sailors and Marines, 44 guns on board, mostly 18-pounders that could launch their cannonade. The Macedonia had less guns, 36 of them, some of them heavier in cannon shot, but many of them lighter, 12 pounds. So he understood that for this battle, he had a distance advantage. If he could stay further away rather than closer, he had a better chance of winning. And that's how he ended up winning this battle, not by going in close and going hand to hand, but by actually crossing the bow, or crossing the T as it's known in naval battle, and he actually got off 70 broadsides compared to only 30 from HMS Macedonia in a battle that lasted less than an hour. When they actually came aboard, after he physically demasted Macedonia and they came aboard, there were over 1,000 holes within the ship. And the truth of this amazing story, and in fact, the desk from USS United States is right here in the Decatur House, where he wrote his end of battle report. As they were lashed together for 2 weeks, he made an amazing decision. We will repair the ship and sail it back to the United States. And it was the first time in American history, the first time in any Navy battle, where a captain brought back the spoils of victory. And they sailed it into Newport Harbor, and that's truly where Decatur became a national hero.
Where is the Macedonian figurehead now?
So the Macedonia was actually recaptured, renamed as a USS ship, served for over 10 years as a USS ship. And interestingly, the Naval Academy's training vessel was the second USS Macedonia and served as a training vessel at the United States Naval Academy for over 60 years. So great history with the name Macedonia.
It is indeed. I want to ask one bit of history about the title Commodore, because you don't hear that. Admiral, is it a honorary title? Is it an actual military rank?
Well, I'd like to speak a little bit, but I'd like to also let Admiral Harvey take some of this as the head of Navy personnel. I think he could speak more definitively on this rank, because it was actually resurrected for a while in our Navy, and Admiral can speak to that. Today, the rank of Commodore is more of a positional authority rather than a rank. As many people know, our flag ranks today are Rear Admiral lower half at 1-star, Rear Admiral upper half is a 2-star, Vice Admiral 3-star, Full Admiral 4-star. But in our early days of our Navy, we didn't have any admirals. And in fact, it would be many decades before Commodore Barry would be bestowed that ceremonial rank, becoming kind of our first admiral of the United States Navy. But Admiral Harvey, I think you could probably talk about this this period of time where we thought about bringing back the rank of Commodore.
Well, we actually did, and one of our secretaries of the Navy, I don't know if it's one of those who are here today, but we did bring back the rank of Commodore. It's just a little bit of inter-service hoorah here. in days of old, when a Navy officer was promoted to flag rank, he went right to 2-star admiral, to the great consternation of the United States Air Force, United States Army and the United States Marine Corps, who had camped out as brigadier generals, one star. And so this was considered to be an extraordinary injustice by some, and just by others, just the way God intended it to be. And so, but as we were pursuing greater jointness in our history, the Navy acceded to the desires to have a one-star rank. And as Admiral Carter said, we instituted the rank of Commodore Admiral as one star. Now, that just sounded so silly when saying it. We changed that to Rear Admiral Lower Half. But that was the one time in the modern Navy that Commodore actually was a rank. Today, if you are a captain who's in charge and command of a squadron of destroyers, as Admiral Carter mentioned, you have the honorific of Commodore, or a submarine squadron is known as the Commodore. But that's kind of where we are today as far as Commodore and Admiral goes.
Zach, the after in 1815, it is written that Stephen Decatur replied to a toast after a successful engagement abroad. He said the famous words, "Our country in her intercourse with foreign nations, may she always be in the right, but our country right or wrong." That kind of philosophy, what does your generation of Navy, future Navy officers look at in terms of America's engagement around the world? Because you will represent the United States around the globe.
Right, definitely. And I mean, we have a lot of classes at the Naval Academy that help support us with that. And I think as we go forward, you know, you talk to different people and have different experiences. And you know, as you further on in your development as an officer, for me, just learning from different experiences, and just knowing that, you know, the people before you have done a great job, and the people that are you're relieving will help you out and kind of point you in the right direction.
Do you feel that your academy years have given you not only the narrow focus on military, but to be a leader in the world today, you have to be a much more broadly educated in the arts and sciences, history, literature, music. Do you think America's Navy, the education you're getting now, is going to give you that kind of background?
Without a doubt. I mean, at the Naval Academy, we have different majors that we choose, but we also have a lot of core classes. Like I was just talking about, I'm a political science major, but that doesn't mean I just study political science material. I get the core classes. We have three history classes, physics 1 and 2, chemistry 1 and 2, calculus 1, 2, and 3. So we get a wide variety of information that we have to take, and I think that definitely helps us broaden you know, what we have to do. And it's the same way when we go into the Navy or Marine Corps. We'll have a greater sense of what needs to get done.
And of course, technology has changed all of our businesses, all of our lives. But technology in the hands of America's military is transforming. Is it hard to look back at a Stephen Decatur's era of sails and high seas and see lessons there that still apply to the incredible technical digital world you live in now?
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty amazing to go back and see and just see what all they have done in that, you know, just sailing throughout the night and, you know, knowing where to go and what reefs to watch out for without the radar and different sonar technology that we have nowadays. But, you know, some of the stuff that you hear about in history classes, it's really crazy to see.
Yeah, let me ask Admiral Carter, in terms of educating, what do you do now to educate the modern sailor?
Yeah, you know, as we think about what midshipmen at the forming of our country were trained in, how they became officers of the Navy, we are quite a bit different. There's a formal part of the education over their four-year development that has tried and true. They still have to learn basic science, English history, navigation. Celestial navigation is still taught at the Naval Academy. But as Zach spoke to, they have the opportunity to do electives and take classes that will give them a specialty. And then the age-old question about how do you teach somebody to become a future leader? You know, we give them some leadership classes. They get classes in philosophy and understanding the needs of themselves and the people that they'll lead. But what has changed dramatically in education, and I think this is happening not just at places like West Point, Air Force Academy, the Naval Academy, they're happening at all levels of higher education. This idea of being immersed into learning. In other words, learning is no longer passive. You don't go into a classroom, have somebody tell you something, and then you regurgitate it to validate that you know what you were given. Now it's putting yourself into the experience. And for us at the Naval Academy, that is 100% what we are about. It's the immersive opportunity. So it's not just what midshipmen like Zach have done in terms of their athletic career. It's the opportunities they get in the summer where they get to go lead youth, whether they be future midshipmen, Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, people from underrepresented parts of our country, where they will be put in a leadership role. And then, of course, they have their own leadership structure within the brigade of midshipmen. Zach is a two-striper, so he is in charge of not just underclassmen, but some of his peers. This is the crucible that is now time-tested, but also needs to change and evolve to keep the newer generation wanting to be the future leaders of not just our Navy and our Marine Corps, but for our nation.
And it's also operating in not only a campus atmosphere, but in a country and a global economy which is far more diverse than it was in
yes.
Stephen Decatur's day.
Yes.
John?
Yeah, Ann, I think you brought up a real interesting point. Admiral Carter was talking about it from the perspective at the Naval Academy. As a fleet commander, one of the things I always wanted to try to do was find a way to make the Navy's past real to the Navy's sailors of today. Not just because it's a cool story, but because what was demanded of those sailors, what was demanded of Stephen Decatur when he led that boarding party onto the Philadelphia in what Nelson called the most daring act of the age, is what's demanded of our sailors today. And I think it is an extraordinary benefit to find the way to bring it into context to the Navy today, to the sailors today. In 1960, my father gave me this book, the American Heritage Junior Library, Naval Battles and Heroes. And I was 9 years old at the time, in case you were wondering. So the hook was set early on for me. But today, what do you give a 9-year-old to try to start telling the story of how this nation, how this Navy came about, and what it took in terms of the human effort and the sacrifice and the service to bring us to where we are today? How do we bring this story alive? It may be through a movie. Admiral Carter and the team at the Naval Academy do a fabulous job in a very, very packed schedule, as Zach could probably tell you. There's not a whole lot of time just sitting around wondering what I'm going to do today. You know, they're jammed with a lot to do. But how do you bring this to the sailors today, I think, is a real serious challenge, and one that we haven't yet solved for the Navy. Because there's too much to learn from, too much to understand that is directly applicable to what's going on all around the world today.
In a moment, we're going to take questions from all of you. And before we do, I want to talk a little bit about what Matt Costello, our senior historian, described to me as the time when Stephen Decatur made that transition, leaving the sea behind and taking his newfound wealth to Washington, buying this land when this neighborhood was a President's Park, a White House, St. John's Church, but not a lot else. Admiral Harvey, if you could start by talking about how Stephen Decatur got his wealth. I mean, it was a different compensation than today's. Why do you think he came and settled in Washington?
Well, I think as far as how he generated such great wealth so early, under the idea that Congress awarded prize money. And so when he had a good reason to bring the Macedonian back, it was worth an awful lot of money to him and his crew. And so the term was prize money, authorized by the Congress at the recommendation of the then Secretary of the Navy. So a very strong career that put you in harm's way also provided for the fortunate few the startings of a very nice family fortune. So it was Stephen Decatur with prize money that he invested in real estate very wisely and picked well on Lafayette Square, and the rest is, as you say, is history. But I think when he came back after the time of his command of the United States, he continued to serve, was a, one of the naval commissioners, one of the board, a three-officer board who advised the Secretary of the Navy on all things that the Navy should be doing, the kind of ships, the kind of people, et cetera. He served a significant policy role, and this was a good place to do it. And I think it was mentioned by Mr. Costello earlier what might have been had he lived. And I think Stephen Decatur, knowing he had a very outsized role in society and recognized, like very few were at that time, up and down the East Coast, national figure, national hero, I think, Ann, he may have had his eyes on some sights beyond just being a retired naval officer, as wonderful as that is. and there could be nothing better than that, but he may have had his eyes on something, and this was a very convenient place to do it, and he had the wherewithal to make it happen.
And he and Susan Decatur built this home in 18, moved in 19.
Right, 14
and, of course, it was still the early days of the, but his friends were presidents, and President, he, a couple of days before his death, went to a wonderful dinner for the president's daughter who was engaged to be Maria Monroe. This was a guy who had taken that sea experience, the leadership and the adventurism that he enjoyed, and turned it into a very, very potent presence in this city. Admiral, could you talk a little bit about how he returned to this house? What those last days of his life, which cut short a really brilliant career?
Well, the actual cause of the duel was the resurrection of an old argument with Captain Barron, who was the commanding officer of the frigate Chesapeake. In 1807, before the War of 1812, yet at a time when the Royal Navy was impressing seamen off of U.S. ships, interfering with trade and seamen's rights, called out to the captain, then Baron, of the Chesapeake in Norfolk, that he believed that there were British deserters on board, and called the ship out and challenged it and fired a broadside. The Chesapeake came out, was not ready for combat, not ready for much of anything. It was on a transit to the Mediterranean. And so it was a great, great disaster for the ship. Many were killed. Ship was taken by the British and the Leopard. The seamen were taken off. Not a good day for the United States Navy. There was a court-martial. Decatur sat on that court-martial, and Captain Barron of the Chesapeake was suspended, essentially, from the Navy for a period of about 5 years. He went to South America, went broke, had a disastrous personal life after that, and, as you might expect, held a significant grudge against those members of the court, of which Stephen Decatur was one. And so, come back full circle, Barron is back in the United States. Decatur has moved here to establish his presence with his family, with his wife, and Barron shows up, and the rest, as they say, is history. The old argument came back, and as Admiral Carter talked about, this extraordinary sense of personal honor that demanded confrontation and demanded an act of extraordinary danger and courage to satisfy one's sense of honor. And that took place in Bladensburg, Maryland, and the wound proved fatal. So that was where it came from. Barron came back.
It was the era where many Americans are now familiar with Hamilton and the Alexander Hamilton's, during the musical, several times is involved in duels. They went across the water from Manhattan to Weehawken, and in the musical, when they, you know, dueling was illegal, but why they in the musical they ask, why do you go over to Weehawken? Because everything's legal in New Jersey. So this duel with Stephen Decatur and Barron was just across the Maryland line. And he was brought back to this home, and this is where he died and cut that historic life short, which means the Hollywood production will have a weepy ending, just as Hamilton did. With that, I would like to invite those of you in the audience, if you would like to ask a question, and I've got the first hand up right over here. Yes, sir, thank you.
So I'll take a first shot at that. There's no question that Stephen Decatur was the early definition of really the ethos that we represent in our Navy. He was bold, he was daring, he was decisive, and he was victorious in just about every engagement he ever entered into. You know, during my time, I have experienced going from what I would call the analog Navy. I flew an F-4 Phantoms that had nothing digital in them, to going into the beginnings of the digital Navy and the F-14 Tomcat and the F-18 Super Hornet. Granted, when I started flying, some of the most dangerous things you could do is just to fly and maybe land on a pitching deck aircraft carrier. But I have personally witnessed young lieutenants making incredibly courageous decisions in the air over combative territory, being fired at over the country of Kosovo in 1999 against a mobile surface-to-air 6-style missile, close-in, mobile, not knowing where they were. And instead of just evading and not being shot down, they turned right around and fired and went head-to-head with them and took out those sites. So that type of instinctual daring still exists, whether that was in the 1990s or going into the 2020s. We see this and the midshipmen that we have at the Naval Academy. I will tell you from my seat, as the head of an institution that's in charge of developing those future leaders, I am incredibly optimistic that that fighting ethos that existed in Stephen Decatur, it's still there today for our Navy officers and our Marine Corps officers.
Yes, Martha. And Martha, we have a microphone. Could we pass that over? Martha Kumar, one of the board members here, and also a longtime colleague of mine in the White House press room.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I wondered what the impact of his death was by dueling, whether nationally there was a sense of great loss in by means that somebody just should not have been dying at that time period. What was the impact within the Navy and nationally?
Well, I think you get an idea of the impact nationally if you look at what was involved in his funeral. I mean, it was, it reminded me, quite frankly, you can read about it, it's in the sitting room there. There's a, on one of the walls, there's a short little story about it from the time. Yeah. And everybody who was anybody in Washington went. It was like burying a president these days. Mm-hmm. I mean, the Congress, the president, all the prominent figures were there, as well as so many of his shipmates and much of the Navy. So the idea was his death was known, it was known nationally, and it was considered a tremendous tragedy for the nation, not just for the Navy. Now, as to the history of dueling, it continued. It was the nature of the time. That sort of behavior was going to be expected, and it was carried out. So it didn't end dueling in the United States, but certainly it had an impact on the Navy as well.
Did it have within the Navy, was there a reconsideration of whether people should be involved in?
Well, you gotta remember in the Navy, we just now ended bread and water as a punishment for young people. So we don't do change real fast, okay? We can change a lot, but not everything. And it did not have that impact. It was considered a great loss, but he was considered to have gained great honor through having fought the duel.
I was just looking for something positive to have come out of such a tragic death.
I think the positive is dueling did end. It might have taken a couple of decades for it to finally end, but it did end. And I'm not so sure that Decatur's loss of life, by the way, Admiral Harvey covered this so well, but what's lost a little bit in the translation, remember when they dueled, the sharpshooter's duel was 10 paces. In this particular case, Barron was an overweight, horribly shaped, and the seconds for the duels allowed this to be a four pace apart duel. It was a death shot. And so somebody was going to die. And sharpshooters like Decatur himself would often never take the death shot. They would shoot somebody's hip or their thigh or their elbow. So this was set up for Decatur to die. And their seconds were responsible for that. Mm-hmm. And that's the aftermath of this duel that's not well talked about or discussed in how this thing went down.
Well, as a strategist, how did he get himself pulled into that?
I would tell you, and Admiral Harvey, I think, could add to this. There was a part of Stephen Decatur that there was no duel that he didn't like. I think he really liked that kind of excitement. He was involved in dozens of them, whether he be the shooter or the second. So this was a flaw, if there was one in him, that he just couldn't turn one down. He didn't have to duel Barron. That grudge match had already been set. So Admiral, I know you've got more to add to some of that.
Well, no, I think you nailed it. It's the nature. He's the, as Zach said, he's the first one on the ship, the last one off it, and that was a pattern of behavior throughout his entire career, and that also translated into how he did business ashore, and he was never going to step away from a challenge. If you read any of the biographies about him, you'll see countless. They're not just duels, but they are confrontations over the right thing, over his honor, over his judgment, and he never backed down from any one of those confrontations at all. It was just the nature of the beast.
Zach, does that have some resonance for midshipmen?
By not backing down? I mean, without a doubt. I guess one thing that came up to my mind in our era is Lieutenant Travis Mannion, who graduated from the Naval Academy. And he's a Marine Corps, and he selflessly... he died in Fallujah, but he was, I'm sure a lot of you guys know the story. He sacrificed his life for his platoon members. And, you know, that's just something that, you know, we get taught all these leadership lessons, especially at the Naval Academy, but that's something that comes from within. That's a leadership quality that you should aspire to have. You know, his famous quote is, "If not me, then who?" And, you know, I believe that's something that, you know, Stephen Decatur influenced him.
We have a question way over here, another insider question.
Anyone on the panel, is the Navy today promoting the risk takers, the Decatur-like risk takers?
Well, first you have to find them to promote them, okay? So there has to be circumstances that bring forward the people who will take the great risk. It's very interesting that we haven't had a major fleet action in the United States Navy since 1945, really. 44, the Battle of Leyte Gulf. So the number of times that you have had actions between ships, involving ships, quite frankly, have been very, very few. Now, the one exception to that has been naval aviation. From a period of time before the Kuwait War up until now, naval aviation has been involved in combat continuously since 1991, from Desert Storm to Southern Watch, to everything else that has followed there. So I think we have a pretty good idea, and I'll speak very frankly. As Chief of Naval Personnel, we had a very, very good idea in terms of aviation. Those who were the standouts, those who led in the air, as Admiral Carter talked about, we knew who they were because they were doing it, because it was demanded of them as lieutenants, it was demanded of them as lieutenant commanders, and it was demanded of them as commanding officers. And so I think we had a very, very good idea of that. In the other communities, it's a little more difficult. The submariners are out alone and unafraid. They do their thing off. I never know what they do when they're out there, but they say they do an awful lot, and I take their words for it, you know? And then in surface land, you did all kinds of things. But the actual getting into combat and find out those people. Now, I know risk takers involves more than just that. But who will be the ones that fight? Back to the first question. The expectation, the culture that was set was, if there's a fight, you're going to fight. And if you're going to fight, you're going to win. That was the single frigate actions of the War of 1812 that set the standard for our Navy that carries through today. But finding the risk takers is very, very difficult in a zero-defect society, in a zero-defect bureaucracy. And so making that work is a challenge for all of us who were in positions of responsibility and authority, and I think it continues today. I don't think you're ever going to get a satisfactory answer to your question. You know, are we promoting them all? We'll find out when push comes to shove that we have the right people with the right stuff. So far, my experience has been that we have. And on the main, we do a pretty good job of putting the right people in the right place.
We have time for one more question. Gail West.
I just want to know, what happened to Barron after the duel?
He was wounded, but not fatally. He recovered and died a few years later. He never recovered his fortune, he never recovered his family, he never recovered his name. So it was just off into the waste.
For Commodore Decatur, the book that has been published here that describes the funeral procession when his body left here to go to a burial spot in Kalorama, the neighborhood, the city turned out by literally thousands and thousands of people, and walking in the dirt streets behind the casket and behind the family was the President of the United States, the entire cabinet, the Supreme Court, and members of Congress taking Stephen Decatur to his burial spot. And it was a symbol that I think we don't see in this day and age, unless it is someone who has also ascended to the kind of political level of a John McCain or a George Herbert Walker Bush, who embodies that kind of American spirit. And it really makes Stephen Decatur the must-see blockbuster Oscar winner. Thank you all very much. Please thank our panel, Admiral Harvey, Midshipman Abey, Admiral Carter. Thank you, gentlemen, for being here.
Really appreciate the great job that you did. We will celebrate this great event again next year, and Matt Costello, our senior historian, will tell you a little about what's planned for next year. So, Matt.
Just a few housekeeping things as well. If you haven't seen it yet, the Stephen Decatur House book, it's an incredible piece of scholarship. It was actually written by four different authors, and it covers Stephen Decatur's biographical life, the design of the house by Benjamin Henry Latrobe, a history of the collections and some of the artifacts and objects that are in there, and then the site's transition from private home to historic site in the 1950s, and it's filled with incredible illustrations, photographs. I highly recommend that you stop at our shop and take a look, and there is a 10% discount if you happen to mention that you participated here today at the lunch. I just want to thank our panelists again, Secretary Dalton, of course, for leading the way, Admiral Carter, Admiral Harvey, Mr. Abey, Midshipman Abey, and Ann Compton for wonderful questions, a very intellectually stimulating session. We appreciate you all here today.
Big hand for the panel.
So next year will be the fifth Stephen Decatur birthday luncheon, and we've already made the decision that next year the topic will revolve around Stephen Decatur and James Barron, and that correspondence back and forth. So we'll get much more into contextualizing that rivalry, how one thing led to another. We've heard some great stories today about the duel itself and the aftermath, but next year we will highlight that correspondence in particular. Also, next year, March 22nd, will be the 200th anniversary of Stephen Decatur's untimely death. So we are anticipating doing something in Philadelphia, where Stephen Decatur is buried today. So on behalf of the White House Historical Association, thank you so much for attending today. I will be in Decatur House milling around and up in the slave quarters. I encourage you to stop by, and I'd be happy to take your questions there. So thank you again, and enjoy the rest of your day.
Just one more word. If you have not been to the Decatur House, we encourage you to take a moment to go through there. The Stephen Decatur desk is in the living room, and it was aboard the USS United States, which took the HMS Macedonia, and encourage you to see that, and I think you'll enjoy seeing the historic parts of that home. Thank you very much for being here. We're